All right. So I hope you're able to see the screen pretty clearly, right? Every one of you. You have to unmute and speak because I guess now I won't be able to see your chat. So you're able to see the slide, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So let's go into the inert gases. They are basically the group 18. Okay, and we have elements like helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, and radon. Okay, so we have these elements, and their corresponding electronic configuration is given in here. Now, if you look at the electronic configuration, the helium only has a difference that it is having a electronic configuration of 1s2, but rest of the elements have a general electronic configuration of NS2 NP6. All of them has NS2 NP6. So that would be the general configuration for the noble gas elements. Now, as you are aware that they are called as inert gases, and they are also sometimes called as rare gases. Okay, but it's a kind of misnomer. Misnomer means it is a wrong terminology we use it, okay, because they are not completely inert, because we know that some of the elements like xenon, okay, they are not inert, but they rather form some compounds. I'll be discussing them in the coming slides. Okay, so xenon is not inert, so it is a misnomer, but still, since it had been used for a longer time, still these names continue. The name the rare gases, okay, this name is also a misnomer, because you know the argon in it is present in the air. Almost like 0.9% is present in the air, and we know our atmosphere is full, is it has a lot of volume of air. So that means 0.9% makes a lot of amount. Okay, so calling it as rare gases means it's like negligible. So it's not the case. We have sufficient an amount of noble gas present in our atmosphere, and most of the time, those who are going to take up this topic on separation of noble gases, they will be talking about their occurrences. So you'll see that noble gases are found in air as well. So this name, again, the rare gases, is also a misnomer. It's not a correct terminology being used, but since we have been using it for a longer time, we still have these names. Another name that you would have come across is the name called noble gases. Okay, that's because they tend to be little bit unreactive. They are not as reactive as other elements we have studied so far. So this name is quite suitable for the group 18, that is the noble gas, similar to the term that we use for noble metals like gold, platinum, which are unreactive. Okay, so those, in those terms, this noble gases is quite an appropriate nomenclature for the group 18. Okay, so this is about the names that are given for the various names given to the group 18. Now, as I just now told, the general electronic configuration of them is NS2, NP6. Okay, and this electronic configuration, if we look into, they are kind of a completely filled state. So that means it's a very stable electronic configuration. And this itself is the reason why they are kind of chemically a little bit inactive. Okay, so they are not very reactive as you find the other elements. Okay, another important thing is this noble gases are inert gas. So now I'll be using all the terms: noble gas, inert gases, rare gases, because all these names are being used for the group 18. Okay, so just keep in mind, whenever I'm talking about rare gases or inert gases or group 18 elements, it's all connected with the same family. Okay, so this group 18, they have an electron affinity that is almost zero. That we can understand because it is already completely filled. It doesn't have an orbital available to accept the electron, and therefore these have a kind of zero electron affinity. They do not accept any electron, because if it accepts, then it is going from its stable state to another high energy state, so that the atom will not prefer to happen, because atoms always prefer to have a lower energy state. So lowest energy is when the electronic configuration is completely filled. Okay, so that is why it has an electronic affinity of almost zero, and they have very high ionization energy. This also is pretty understood from the fact that these electronic configurations are completely filled. Okay. And they have very little tendency to form bonds, and so they exist usually as the single atom. Okay, that you can easily understand for any compound formation. If ionic compound, there should be some kind of loss or gain of electrons happening. But since noble gas being in their stable electronic configuration, they tend to do not undergo this kind of gain or lose of electrons, and therefore the compound formation is like almost not happening. Okay, and sharing also is not a very good for these noble gases, and that is why they have very little tendency to form any kind of bond. So noble gas exist in nature as single atoms. They exist as single atoms, and among them you have some van der Waal interactions which are making them to come closer to each other. Otherwise they do not exist as a molecule, but they exist in their atomic states. Coming to their physical properties, they are kind of colorless, odorless, monatomic gases. Okay, and their enthalpy of vaporization is pretty low, as you can understand, since they do not have a molecular state. They only have a monoatomic state, so whatever interaction between atoms is happening is all van der Waal interactions, weak van der Waal interactions. So it is very easy to evaporate them from one state to the gaseous state, and that is why they have a very low value for the enthalpy of vaporization. Okay, and here there is written enthalpy of vaporization increases down the group as polarizability of the atom increases. That is understood. As you move down the group, as the size becomes little larger, they are more polarizable. So van der Waal forces, which are weak dipole moment for interactive forces that are happening, will become more prominent. So that is why as you move down the group, you have a kind of a little bit stronger bonding happening, but it's not significantly stronger. But still, as you move down the group, there is a enhancement in the enthalpy of vaporization. Similarly, melting and boiling point also would be very low, because the interatomic forces are weak van der Waal forces. Obviously, they are not strong enough to make a very high contribution to a very high melting or a boiling point. Further, another interesting thing that you would note here is that the atomic radii of the elements are very, very large. Okay. Now you might be thinking, like, as we move from the left to the right side of the periodic table, the atomic radii should be what, decreasing, right? But you find that this radii, the radii here mentioned, like 1.2, 1.6, up to 2.2, these are pretty much closer and higher than your group one, that is your alkali metals. Now you would be surprised why they have a little bit higher value of this covalent radii. Why it is so high? That is that can be understood like this, because they have a very completely filled electronic subshell, Okay, so since the electrons are in majority in the valence shell, they would tend to have a little bit of electronic repulsion happening between the electrons of the subshell. Okay, so because of the slight electronic repulsion that you find in these valence electrons, you have a slight increment in the covalent radii as opposed to your usual decrease that is happening as you move from left to right in a periodic table. And down the group, the understood that why it is increasing, because as you move, new shells are being added, so obviously covalent radii will increase. But across the period, why there is an increment is because of the electronic repulsion that you find between the filled subshells of the valence electron. That electronic repulsions make them a little bit enhanced in their covalent radii. Okay, so that is why they have a pretty larger value of atomic radii. This you have to always keep in mind. Okay, another important thing that you will find in here is these noble gases are like can diffuse through glasses. You cannot contain them in glasses. Okay, they will diffuse to rubber, plastic material, and even some metals also they will diffuse it. So usually, in order to handle them in laboratory, it is quite difficult. You require specialized flask for holding these noble gases. Okay, so this is about the general physical property of the noble gas. All these screenshots that I have taken is from the book of J.D. Lee, so you can refer to them. Okay, just for reading. And coming to the chemical properties, okay, as I just now talked to you that these noble gases are kind of a little bit unreactive. So because of their unreactivity and lack of reactivity, people used to isolate noble gases because they can use them for various reactions in which you require inert conditions. Okay, so that is the purpose why noble gases was being isolated previously. So before 1962, there was like no evidence of a proper compound of noble gas known. Only we knew some molecular ions being formed in discharge tube or clathrate compound. Molecular ions means when you subject these noble gases in a discharge tube with high electric field, okay? So there is a formation of these ionic molecular species, but they are not proper compounds, okay? They are formed as a result of the transitionary electron movement. It's not like a proper electron movement. So as soon as you stop applying the electric field, this will go back to its original atomic state. So it's not a proper compound, but you do observe these molecular ions in the discharge tube for a small period of time till which you are applying the electric field across those discharge tubes. Okay, then you will find them in clathrate compounds. Clathrate compounds is also not a proper compound. This is like, suppose you crystallize an ionic compound or any covalent compound in your liquid state, and then crystallize. ചില സമയത്ത് ഈ നോബിൾ ഗ്യാസസ് ഇഫ് യു ഹാവ് ഇൻ ദ സൊല്യൂഷൻ ഇറ്റ് ഗെറ്റ് ട്രാപ്ഡ് ഇൻ ടു ദ ഇൻറ്റർസ്റ്റീഷ്യൽ സൈറ്റ്സ് ഓഫ് ദീസ് ക്രിസ്റ്റൽസ് ഓഫ് ദി അതർ കമ്പൗണ്ട്സ് ഓക്കെ സോ ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ലൈക്ക് ട്രാപ്പിംഗ് ഓഫ് ദീസ് നോബിൾ ഗ്യാസ് ഇൻസൈഡ് ദ ക്രിസ്റ്റൽ ലാറ്റസ് ഓഫ് അതർ കമ്പൗണ്ട്സ് ഓക്കെ സോ ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് എ ട്രാപ്ഡ് കമ്പൗണ്ട് ഓക്കെ സോ ദിസ് കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് കമ്പൗണ്ട്സ് ഇൻ വിച്ച് ദി സ്മോൾ മോളിക്യൂൾസ് ഗെറ്റ് ട്രാപ്ഡ് ഇൻ ടു ദ crystal lattice of other compounds. These are called as clathrate compounds. So clathrate compounds are not only known with noble gases, but they are also known with other molecules like O2, N2. Okay, and even water vapor also can be trapped. Okay, so such trapped compounds are called clathrate compounds. So again, these two forms that was known before 1962, they are not proper compounds. Okay, so during till 1962, people believed that noble gas are really noble, they are inert, and there is no reactivity of it. Okay, but soon after around 1962, in the year 1962, a scientist named Bartlett and Lohmann, okay, these two scientists, what they found was that when they reacted with the oxidizing compound, that is platinum hexafluoride, when they reacted with dioxygen, what they formed is, they formed a compound, a complex basically like this, where you have excited O2 to O2 positive. So that means if you draw the molecular orbital configuration for O2, it is highly stable electronic configuration. So it doesn't have a very easy tendency to lose electron. But this hexa fluoroplatinum compound, they are very oxidizing in nature, that they are able to oxidize O2 to O2 positive. Okay, and the ionization energy, if we try to calculate for this O2 molecule, it is approximately 1165 kilojoule per mole. And if we look into the ionization energy, the first ionization energy for xenon, it is 1170. So it is kind of quite near to the value of this particular excitation. So this made the scientists to think that xenon can also react in a similar way. So they reacted xenon gas with platinum fluoride, and they saw some yellow solid being formed. Okay. So initially they thought that the compound would be something like that. Like if you react with xenon, if it is xenon which react chamber, compound endu irikum xenon positive plus this. So that is what they expected. Idu compound aanu avaru expect cheythathu. Okay, pakshe later on it was found that it is a compound with a fairly complex reaction like this. So if you look at this reaction, you can quite easily see that when this xenon platinum F6 reacts with platinum, it forms a positively charged and a negatively charged species like this, which further react with PtF5, because after the donation of an F fluorine atom, it becomes PtF5. It join along with this to form idu vechu idu add cheyumbol Pt2 F11 varu. Okay, so you got this particular compound. Okay, so after the formation of this compound, it was now known that the noble gases are not completely inert, but they are reactive. Soon after, what happened, they found another reaction in which they reacted xenon with fluorine at a temperature of 400 degree, and they got the formation of solid FxeF4, okay, which was kind of isoelectronic with the this kind of poly halide, okay, iodine tetrachloride. Okay, so this led to the formation of various compounds. Now, among the various elements in the noble gas, xenon are the ones that are pretty reactive and form compounds. Xenon kaini varuna element is not that reactive, and the bottommost radon is radioactive. So usually that is also very less reactive. So most of the compound that are known for the noble gas are known for the xenon atom. Above xenon atom, all the elements are inert. They usually do not react to form the compounds. Now, here we have a table that shows the various compounds that are reported for the xenon. So in your syllabus, you have to study the structure of oxides and fluorides of xenon. Okay, so all the xenon oxides and xenon fluorides you have to study. So these are the xenon fluorides that are known. Okay, and these are the corresponding oxides being reported for the xenon compound. Okay, now what you have to do is we will start discussing this particular compound, that is XeF2, and then I would expect others would be following in the similar direction. You can easily solve them. Okay, so let us try to find out what is the structure of the XeF2. Okay, so let us try to do that. So let me start with the XeF2. So let me use black pen only. XeF2. Okay, in the structure ana nammal we are going to try to decipher. Okay, so let us use BACPR theory, because I guess that is a little bit okay for you guys. So VSEPR theory like nammal pogumbol how we will do, we will first calculate the number of valence electron, right? Number of valence electron. I'm trying to use the limited space that I have, because I want to discuss something important with the xenon fluoride. Okay, that is why I'm doing that structure. Rest of them you can easily do with your BACPR ILM, BBTR ILM, you can easily do it. Okay, so the number of valence electron, if we try to calculate, it would be xenon de case valence electron would be 8, then fluorine de case it would be 7 multiplied by 2. So it is 8 plus 14. 8 plus 14. So 8 plus 14 number chain board, it will become 12 1 2. So 22 valence electrons are present in this particular molecule. Let us now try to make a Lewis structure. So if we try to make the Lewis structure, we will see this particular molecule, xenon would be kind of the ones, xenon aerikum nammada case la central atom, because one important thing is xenon is kind of one element present in this particular molecule. So usually the central atoms are present as a single atom. Another looking factor is that xenon being a little bit less electronegative than compared to fluorine. So obviously less electronegative atoms also try to make the central atom. Okay, so in that way we have at the center you have the xenon, and then you have it flanked with the fluorine. Perfectly fine. Okay, so initially as we do, we will join them with bonds. Okay, so you have to subtract now 4 electrons from the bond pair. So it would be kind of 18, right? So it is 22, 11. So it is 18 electrons. Okay, so 18 electrons we have to arrange around these molecule. So 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 12 13 14 15 16. Then you cannot arrange around fluorine, because fluorine already got 8 electron, but xenon you can add, because xenon coming in the fifth shell, so it has d orbital, so it can expand its valency, so you can add more electrons on the xenon. So I hope now it is complete. So 18 electrons we have arranged around it. Okay, now the next job would be to find the shape. Okay, So how do we find the shape? So if we try to calculate the formal charges here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so it would be minus 1. Okay, here again it would be minus 1. And xenon de case later through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, and 8. So it is perfectly a zero charge. So it is kind of a negatively charged, it's not a very neutral molecule, but rather it's a negatively charged molecule. And that is why you see, it is zero, right? You didn't correct me. It is zero, right? I was getting confused. How can it be? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Number of valence electrons for halogen is 7. So it should be zero, right? So it's a perfectly correct structure in which every element is getting a zero structure. I don't know why you guys are always like accepting everything that I say. You should have a counter opinion about, you shouldn't accept, you know certain facts. Okay, if I'm doing something wrong, you should say, sir, you have done wrong. It's 7, so it should be not minus 1, but rather 0. You should have told me, but you didn't. You don't care, actually. And that's what I think. So. Otherwise, you would have said to me that I have done it wrong here. Okay, no problem. I hope you will improve slowly. And try to contradict when I'm wrong and do not accept me blindly, everything that I say. You have to believe that what you are thinking is right and you should say those points here. Because I am a human being, I can make mistakes while I'm teaching. So if you know that I'm making a mistake, you should point out those mistakes to me. Okay. Because when you write the examination and if you write like what I have done, okay, and you say, sir, you have cut it wrong, but in your class you did like this, I will not excuse them. Because in examination, I'll mark for the correct thing only, even if I make the mistake in the class. So I expect you to, if I'm doing any mistake, I expect you to find that and let me know if I'm wrong. Okay. So in examination, there would be no excuse on that front. Okay. Okay. So let me see now. If you now count the number of electron pair around the xenon, it's like how many pairs are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So we have 5 pairs of electron around the central xenon atom. Okay, so 5 pairs of electron around the central xenon atom means what? It would mean, what would be the shape? Can anyone of you quickly tell me? If we have 5 pairs of electron around a xenon, around a central atom, what is the shape that you expect? Quickly tell me so that I can quickly move. Hello? Lakshmi. Lakshmi Pavanan. Hello, Lakshmi.
Hello.
So if in the central atom you have 5 pairs of electron, what is the shape that you expect? If in the central atom around you have 5 pairs of electron, what is the shape that you expect?
Hello.
Yes. Can you tell me what is the shape that you expect?
Trigonal.
Trigonal.
Bipyramid.
Okay, why are you so hesitant in saying all these things? A little bit confident in whatever you are saying, because that now is expected of you. Okay, so 5 pairs of electrons are there means the shape should be trigonal. gonal by pyramidal. That is the expected shape, but we don't know the pyramidal. We do not know the geometry. That's what we are going to try to find. So if I want to arrange in this particular format, I would better place it something like this. So at the center, the equilateral triangle, I'll place the lone pairs. Now, are you convinced that I have drawn the correct structure, or you expect fluorine to be somewhere here? Or is it the correct way of writing this? See, you can write it in any way you can, but I am saying that this is the most appropriate. Why I am saying that? Do you think you can, you have any other option? Can you place fluorine here and lone pair here? Why you think I place something like this?
Repulsion or
can electronic repulsions? Yeah, lone pair thammilulla electronic repulsion, because lone pair thammilulla electronic repulsions aanu ethum kooduthal maximum. So if you place it in the equilateral triangle, every they are separated by an angle of 120 degree. Okay, so they are as far as possible in this case, and you also keep fluorine pretty much away, because you know that every fluorine atom has a kind of six pair of lone pairs around it, and if you place it on the somewhere here, then it would be an angle of 90 degree, and these lone pairs being larger in size, they will have a significant electronic repulsion. So it is always better to keep the electronegative fluorine as far as possible, and lone pairs also fairly wider with respect to each other. So the best possible structure you can draw is something like this, xenon, and then on the axial bonds you will place the fluorine atom and the lone pairs on the equilateral triangle. Now the question is, in the examination you are asked to tell me the geometry of the molecule. Okay, you are asked to give me the geometry of the molecule. So what is the geometry of the molecule? So what is the geometry of the molecule?
Linear.
Yeah, it would be a linear, because when you consider the geometry, it should be the bonds that are formed with the central atom that you should take into consideration. So if you look at these the bonds that are formed, it is like bond xenonum e fluorine thammilulla bond ningal sradhikkuvanengil, the geometry is kind of linear. You do not consider the lone pair to look at the geometry. Okay, so the geometry of this molecule is nothing but your linear geometry. Okay, linear geometry. Okay, fine, perfectly fine. So this is a very good approach, and you have fairly come to a right conclusion from the VSEPR theory that this molecule have a linear shape. Now if you look in here at the here they have I have partially shown here the VBT approach. So in the VBT approach you will write the ground state electronic configuration, and since you are forming two bonds here, so you require two unpaired electrons, so you will go to the one excited state here, and then the hybridization, since you have to include these two unpaired electrons, the hybridization would be sp3d. So we know again sp3d means it is trigonal bipyramidal. Trigonal bipyramidal. Okay, so from this also we got to a similar kind of conclusion. Okay, now please listen to me now onwards pretty carefully, because here I'm going to tell you an alternate explanation, and so far VSEPR is kind of what you say, it's not a proper way of finding the structure. A balance pattern is more right way of doing the bond formation, because here we are actually looking into the orbitals that are used for forming the bonds. Okay. So now please, every one of you, listen carefully, and if you find anything that I am saying a little bit not clear, please unmute and speak, okay, because it is important. Okay, that is why I am asking you to pay attention very carefully to what I am saying, the words that I am saying, and the pointer wherever I am pointing it. Okay, so just be attentive now, every one of you. I think you might have little bit diverted because structure le case varumbo ningalku ariyam ningalku ad bscpr bbt vechittiyana. Now I think you are pretty good in that, doing that, so I'm happy with you, with that progress that you have made. Okay, so but whenever you do use the bscpr ilm bbt ilm, please draw it carefully so that you do not lose, because if you make one mistake, there is no point of being correct, it would be completely wrong. Okay, so make sure whenever you approach your answer, be correct. The approach should be correct. Okay. Okay. So here, what is happening is in the BBT approach, if we look into we are actually, in order to form bonds, xenon to form two bonds with the fluorine atom, we are exciting one of the electron, paired electron, to the d subshell. And that's how we are getting the two unpaired electrons to form bonds with the fluorine atom. Okay, but it is an objection that is put forward, is that 5d orbital of xenon appear to be too large for effective overlap of the orbitals. So as you know, that as we increase the size of the shell, the orbitals become larger and larger, so that means they become more and more diffused. Okay, so a diffused orbital or more spread orbital won't form a very good overlap, won't form a very good overlap. Okay, so that is one objection, like then how we are getting an effective bonding between xenon and fluorine, because that bonding is one of the bonding is formed as a result of overlap of a kind of 5d orbital, and it is more diffused. Okay, so it is not a very good overlap that you expect from a 5d and a fluorine atom. So that it was quite contradictory when we took into consideration the BBT approach. Okay, and so that particular objection was partly solved because this fluorine atom being highly electronegative, it is being argued that they somehow contract these 5d orbital, or they shrink these 5d orbital to a smaller size so that they can kind of effectively overlap with the p orbital, p unpaired electron on the fluorine atom. Okay, that is what the alternate explanation gave, but that wasn't very good at seeing about the fluorine atom, but that is what the explanation was given. Another objection that came was the second objection, that is quite reasonable, because here we are telling that in BBT approach, once you have unpaired the electron, the next step would be the hybridization. That is, in this case, it would be a sp3 hybridization is what you expect. Okay, so if this d orbital has to mix along with this s and p orbital, their energy should be similar, because if you remember the Pauling's hybridization definition, usually the mixing is happening between similar energy orbitals. Mixing is happening between the similar in energy orbitals. So it is expected that 5s, 5p and 5d, they are similar in energy. Only then this kind of hybridization is possible. But actually, when you look at the values of the energy levels of 5s, 5p and 5d orbitals, 5s and 5p, they are pretty close to each other, but 5D are little bit higher in energy. They are higher in energy, quite higher in energy, okay? And therefore, the hybridization of S, P, and D is quite unimaginable. Though it is giving you a correct prediction of the structure, but theoretically speaking, if you try to explain the real bonding that is happening, this doesn't give you a very clear picture. It doesn't give you a very clear picture. So that means there should be this valence bond approach is not a very 100% approach to explain clearly the bonding that is happening in these XCF2 molecule. Now, how to solve this problem? Okay, so here I'll show you how molecular orbital theory, that is the MOT theory, okay, MOT theory, that is molecular orbital theory, how it beautifully explains the bonding that is happening in these XCF2 molecules. Okay, XCF2 molecule, engane this molecular orbital theory beautifully explains the bonding that is happening. Okay, so here what we consider is, okay, so this is the please, every one of you, listen carefully. Okay, I hope you're not very much familiar with the application of molecular orbital on the polynuclear front, but so listen carefully. Okay, here we are going to use same thing. Like, one thing I would like to say, molecular orbital theory means what? You have the combination of atomic orbital to find, if two atomic orbitals are combining, it would give rise to two molecular orbitals. One would be bonding, one would be antibonding. Okay, so same way you have to take into consideration. Okay, so here, XCF2 in a case, XCD, ഇവിടെ എഴുതിയേക്കുന്നത് electronic configuration, fluorine electronic configuration, ഇവിടെ നമ്മൾ എഴുതിയേക്കുന്നു. Okay, now what the molecular approach says is that here there is a bonding that is happening between the pz atomic orbital of the xenon, okay, xenon de pz orbital is overlapping with the pz orbital of the fluorine atom. Okay, so let me show you figuratively. So if I draw the p orbit, suppose this green one is my xenon. Okay, let me write xenon also here. So p orbital means what? It is a doubled dumbbell shape. Okay, it's a dumbbell shape that you draw in the xenon. Suppose this particular orientation in which I have drawn in here just now is a orientation for the z axis. Okay, so this would be your pz. Okay, so pz orbital of the let me write it clearly, otherwise I always try to make as less mistake as possible, because you people do not ask me anything, so I fear whether you are a little bit understanding or just somehow bearing it up. Shouldn't be like that. You should understand. That's important. Okay, so here pz orbital is what I have drawn. So z axis in the along gaana idu z axis in e direction la varichengil same direction la irikum ende pz orbital. So this is the pz orbital, this is the pz orbital for the xenon atom. Okay, now I'll go to the as you know, when we draw them, usually we give the phase signs to it. So if this is positively phased, the other dumbbell would be negatively phased. Perfectly fine. Ivide mere ellam clear aanu. So now I am going to denote fluorine with a negative bond, the red color. Okay, so fluorine atom also adinde pz orbital, okay, they are kind of overlapping. So this is not a good picture, because pz orbital should be the same size, but mine is getting bit bigger. Okay, it's okay. So pz orbital ivide. Okay, so these are the fluorine pz orbital. See, why here the orbital is taking place, the overlap is happening between the pz orbitals. Pz orbitals are oriented in the same direction. Okay, pz orbital is oriented in the same direction. Okay, f in the pz ayalum, x in the pz ayalum, they are oriented along the z axis. Okay, so there is a overlap possible in here. Only thing that you have to remember is, since a positive overlap need to take place, you should have a positive lobe here, negative lobe here. In this case, it will be negative and the positive. So it will be a perfect overlap that is possible. And this pretty much explains the linearity of the molecule. See, since all the orbitals are bonding along the same axis, so Xe, Fe, two F atoms, they are all along the same Z axis. So that itself explains the linearity of this particular molecule, that is Xe, F2. If angular agan sadhyade illa, because angular aagumba e orientation change aagum, because I'm talking about the overlap that is happening between the two pz orbitals of the fluorine and the pz orbital of the xenon, and they are all oriented along the z axis, so it should be a proper overlap is possible only when they are linearly arranged. Okay, so now we are going to take into consideration our molecular orbital picture. Now, as you draw for the normal homonuclear molecules, you will try to draw their molecular orbital configuration. So below I am giving you the diagram for that. So you remember this diagram, right? So here you have overlap taking between two pz orbital of the fluorine, and you have overlap taking place between the five pz orbital of the xenon atom. Okay, ee atomic orbitals thammilana bonding happen avunnathu. We are not worried about the other orbitals because they are not involved in any kind of bonding. So in the molecular orbital picture, we are taking only those atomic orbitals which are actually involved in the bonding. Okay, so bonding le a orbital and involved two pz orbitals of the fluorine as well as five pz orbital of the xenon atom. Okay, so I have drawn them slightly different in energy. Now there is a reason for that. As you know, when there is higher shells, as the shell number increases, the energy increases, right? So this is the second shell. Fluorine atom le case le pz orbitals are in the second shell, so they would be lower in energy, and pz orbital of the xenon is the 5pz, so it would be definitely higher than the 2pz orbital. That is why there is an energy difference between the two. Okay, so this much point you are pretty clear. So every time when you draw the homoatomic also, you will draw the atom le orbital the rendu side lum varichittu, then you draw the molecular orbital. Same way here, atomic orbitals which are actually involved in bonding, you draw on the LHS or RHS. Angane ningal idine varichu. Okay, now the second point about the molecular orbital is, etra atomic orbital combine cheyno athre number of molecular orbital form aagum. Ippa rendu atomic orbitals combine aavanengil, it will lead to two molecular orbitals. Okay, so here how many atomic orbitals are combining? Two 2pz orbital and one 5pz orbital. So how many atomic orbitals are combining? Three atomic orbitals. Okay, oru 2pz, oru 2pz and oru 5pz. Total etra atomic orbitals are combine cheynathu? Three atomic orbitals are combine cheynathu. So three atomic orbitals combine cheyumbol, it will give rise to three molecular orbitals. Okay, etra atomic orbitals combine cheyno athre molecular orbitals generate. Okay, so usually when ningalku iduvare ningal padichathu case ningalku only there was two orbitals that are combining, so rendu orbital combine cheyumbol it will always give to one bonding and one antibonding. Anganaana ningal iduvare padichondirunnathu. But here, since you are simultaneously taking into consideration three atomic orbitals combining together, it will give rise to three three different molecular orbital. The lowest one would be always bonding, and the highest one would be always antibonding. Middle portion would be called as the non-bonding orbital. Okay, so three atomic orbital combine to give you bonding, antibonding, and a non-bonding orbital. Okay, now we have to arrange the electrons. So how many electrons are available? Oro 2p z lum or unpaired electron available ana. Nammude xenon de 5p z le rendu electrons available ana. So total we have to arrange 4 electrons on these molecular orbitals. So we will start from the lowest one. So rendu electron ne nammal ivide, because each orbit molecular orbital can accommodate only 2 electrons, so we pair them, then we pair the non bonding. So there is no antibonding electron. So whatever bonding that is happening between these xenon F2 is coming from these two bonding electron. Okay, so this bonding that is happening between the xenon and the 2 fluorine atom. So you have bonding letter electron and how many bonding electrons are there? Only 2 bonding electrons are there. Only 2 bonding electrons are there. So this bonding is like a 3 center. Okay. Basically we will say it is 4 electron because we have 4 electron, but actually sigma bonding le contribute cheyina ethra electrons aanu? Only 2 electrons are contributing into the sigma bond. Okay, so it is kind of 3-center 4 electron bond, similar to what we have studied when we were talking about the bridged compounds. Okay, there we talked about the 3-center 2 electron bond. So it is also a 3-center 2 electron bond, but since the molecular orbital says that the total number of electrons, though these non-bonding electrons are not participating in any kind of bonding, but still they are forming the part of the various molecular orbitals, so that's why we generally tell them as 3-center 4 electron bond. But if you ask me about these 2 sigma bonds, they are actually, according to molecular orbital, is comprising only of 2 electrons. Okay, so this clearly explains molecular orbital theory somehow remove all the anomalies of 5d orbital, the involvement completely namakku ivide remove cheyyam. So ee ore concept of difficulty is completely removed when we talk about the molecular orbital explanation for this particular molecule. Okay, so this clearly shows the linearity. Okay, and it also shows that this molecule bond length also, it is kind of appropriate to being not a usual single bond. Okay, it's slightly longer than that. Okay, and it's not even a double bond. Okay, so that explains that this is not a perfect 2-center 2 electron bond, but rather it is a kind of 3-center 2 electron bond. Okay, and this fourth non-bonding electron, okay, which is not involved in any kind of bonding between the Xe and F, they are usually located on the fluorine atoms, and that gives the electronegativity or the charge separation that you find in these molecules. Okay, and obviously this is a kind of dipole moment nammal calculate cheyumbo usually it should be zero, because both the dipoles would cancel each other being linear in shape. So this is the molecular orbital explanation. So you have a 3-center 4 electron sigma bonding, where the 2 electrons are actually involved in the bonding, and the non-bonding electron, okay, non-bonding electron, these are situated mainly on the fluorine atom and confers some ionic character. Okay, so this approach of explanation is something that you should always keep in mind, which would help you to easily accept the various bonding. Okay, so I wanted to do further, but I guess I won't do it today, because you have your examination. I don't want to force you too much for that. So I hope till this much you understood. In the next class we will try to do the rest of the next class. Namakku baaki ulla